Melissa Murray is a professor of law at NYU who specializes in family and constitutional law. Earlier, I spoke with her about marriage law in the U.S. and why it has been very difficult for advocates to make a change on a federal level. When you look at the evolution of marriage and what's legally allowed and isn't, how has that evolved over the years?
Well, marriage is really different. What we know today of marriage is really different than what was expected even a generation ago. Common law, marriage was a way to pass on property, maybe to make alliances between different clans in order to expand the holding of property or to make different alliances to prevent other groups from coming in and encroaching upon a particular area. So it was much more economic in nature, much more practical, and it's really evolved to be something that's more of a companionate institution where there's an expectation of love and fidelity and trust. There are much more practical concerns about marriage a generation or two ago.
What's really the argument for keeping marriage laws at a state level instead of a federal mandate?
Well, part of it is a constitutional argument. So the Constitution is a document that's aimed at limiting the powers of the federal government, and in limiting the federal government, providing certain powers for state governments and ostensibly the people, who are closer to the states than they are necessarily to the federal government. So when the Constitution was drafted, there are certain things that they don't expect the federal government to be involved in. Education might be one of those things. Certainly marriage has traditionally been one of those things. Criminal laws have been one of those things. And a lot of that's changed over the years. Obviously, there's much more federal intervention in education, even as it remains a traditional state concern. There is much more federal criminal law than there was at the founding. But marriage still seems to be sort of set off as this place where there's incredible diversity at the state level and a real resistance to federal intervention.
When you talk about marriage, in some cases, judges have used marriage as a punishment. Can you explain that?
Well, so this is something I've written a lot about. I think it's absolutely fascinating. I think to understand the idea of marriage as punishment, you really have to understand the function that marriage played in the past and continues to play in the future in a lot of ways. So during the 1800s and 1900s, marriage was all that a woman could hope for if she wanted to provide for herself. There were not a lot of options for women to work, certainly not options that could be really well-paying and you could support yourself honestly on that kind of work. So one court says it quite explicitly, marriage is but a chapter in a man's life, but for a woman, it is the epic of her life. This is the most important economic decision a woman will make for herself, whether and with whom she will marry. And so this idea of marriage as punishment, you have to start from that place. So there were a number of states and in the 1800s, the early 1900s, about 38 American jurisdictions, in fact, that had this crime on the books called seduction. And seduction was meant to kind of bridge the distance between consensual sex outside of marriage, which was a crime, and a kind of coercive sex outside of marriage that wasn't quite rape because maybe you knew him, but it definitely wasn't quite consensual because of certain aspects of it. And in particular, they imagined that men would coerce women into sex by promising them that they would eventually get married. Like, you know, let's just do this this one time, you know I'm going to marry you. But then he never married her. And it was called seduction. And so you had all of these cases in the 1900s where men would be hauled into court by the fathers or brothers of the of women that they'd had sex with, and the charge would be seduction. You defiled my daughter, you defiled my sister by telling her you were going to marry her, and then you never did. And the judge would hear these charges, and then he would say to the defendant, do you want to stand to these charges, or do you want to marry her?
Wow.
And if he said, yes, I will marry her, suddenly everything changed and that courtroom was transformed from a criminal trial to a marriage. And the judge actually performed a marriage of the defendant and his erstwhile victim. And but this was the best part. Nobody thought that the defendant was getting away with it, nor was his victim getting away with anything. She too had committed a crime by having sex outside of marriage. And so it was understood that marriage was not getting out of it. It was actually a different kind of punishment, one in which the couple would be transformed from sexual outlaws into respectable in-laws, right? So marriage was a disciplining institution. Mm. Once married, he would be required to be a husband. He would be sober and he would provide for the family and be there for her. And if he didn't, if he cheated on her, if he stepped out on her, if he left her or abandoned her, they could simply resume the prosecution for seduction. So in a way, when we laugh about the old ball and chain and marriage as a kind of prison sentence, it's only half funny because they understood it to be true.
But ultimately, it's almost like women didn't have a say in this.
So that is certainly true. I mean, but I also think you have to, again, have to understand this. For a woman to have been sexually compromised, to no longer be a virgin at a time when virginity was necessary for most men to get married, she would have had no other marriage prospects. So while she may not have had a choice, it might have been the choice she wanted, because marriage was the epic of her life. To get married was to have economic sustenance, to have an opportunity for children, to be respectable. So she didn't want to be outside of that. And so this was a not great option, but it might have been the only option she had.
You mentioned some of the economic advantages of marriage. Do you believe that child marriage is incentivized when it comes to economics, tax breaks, health insurance?
Well, I think certainly in situations where parents are in limited straits and they may have the opportunity for a child to be with an older partner, there is an incentive to get the child off of your household ledger and onto someone else's. It may be an opportunity for the child as a spouse to have health insurance. If the other person has health insurance, there might be tax consequences that could be advantageous. I don't think anyone sets up these systems with the idea that they are incentivizing child marriage, but as with any system, there certainly might be unintended consequences that could incentivize child marriage.
Why do you think a left-leaning organization like the ACLU was against raising the legal age of marriage in the state of California?
Well, I think part of it, I don't work for the ACLU, but I imagine at least part of the concern there was that there is a lot of interaction between laws that allow for reproductive rights and autonomy for minors that would be compromised if you raised the age of consent to marriage, because it would also perhaps trigger an inquiry about the age of consent to other kinds of procedures, which would be difficult.
Talk to me a little bit more about reproductive rights. How is that impacted when it comes to child marriages that we don't think of, maybe?
Well, so, for example, understanding the relationship between marriage and procreation, I think, is really essential for this. So there are a lot of states where the age of consent for marriage is actually much higher unless the woman is pregnant. And then suddenly it's a different you know, kind of conversation, maybe one where we allow for parental intervention or parental consent to override what might be a traditional age of consent. And so there is a sense that when a minor is pregnant, marriage might be a better option, again, an opportunity for her to be provided for and for the child later to be provided for. And so when you think about that, and then you think about the question of reproductive rights, for a lot of the same reasons, we have an age of consent to a lot of different procedures in order to honor the autonomy of minors, even in situations where we think that they might benefit from the additional help of an adult. So one of the things that might be happening in terms of the interaction between reproductive rights and the age of consent for marriage is there may be a situation where if a minor is married, you might thwart her opportunity to exercise reproductive rights or to exercise her autonomy in that domain, because you'll have this other person who is more than just a parent in terms of being able to object to or not consent to a particular procedure. So I think there's a really interesting relationship there that is underwritten by the link between marriage and procreation.
When you look at the divorce rates of child marriage, something like 70% to 80%, is that statistic reason enough that there should be a federal mandate, do you believe?
So I'm not sure that there should be a federal mandate, in part because I'm not sure it would be constitutional, given that historically this has been something that's been considered an area of traditional state concern, and I don't know what constitutional hook would be available. The federal government, Congress, for example, only has a limited range of constitutional powers under which it can enact laws. So if it's a question of leaving, crossing state lines to get married, then that's something Congress can do because it implicates the Commerce Clause and the commerce power. But if it's simply, I just want to regulate within Georgia and within South Carolina and all these other mm-hmm. states, that's not something that Congress can do. So, I mean, I think it's really difficult to think in terms of a federal law dealing with this unless you're talking about state lines. I think what we could see that would be more plausible is a state-by-state effort to raise the age of consent. And you're seeing that in a lot of places, mm. Kentucky, for example. But obviously, that requires a lot more coordination. There are 50 different jurisdictions that you have to get in line. And they may all have different ideas about what an acceptable age of consent is.
Melissa Murray, thank you very much for joining
us. Thanks for having me.
You bet.